Hi everyone, Aaron here for zollotech, and today Apple released iOS 15 Beta 4. This is available to developers and hopefully soon to public beta testers, as last time it took a day or two for it to show up. Now, sometimes it will be available by the time you're watching this video, so hopefully it's sooner rather than later. And you can see the overall size of this update was 1.21 gigabytes. That's on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. I also have it installed on the iPhone 11 and iPhone 6S Plus, and along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 15 Beta 4 that's on my iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, along with watchOS 8 Beta 4 that's out now as well for developers, also tvOS 15 Beta 4 and macOS Monterey Beta 4. All of those are available now. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then we'll go to General, then About. Now, if we tap on the software version number, we can see the build, which is 19A5307G. And in this particular build, they've updated quite a few things, changed some features, changed the way things looked. But the first thing is they've updated the modem. And so there's a new modem firmware update on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. So if there were issues with connectivity, I've had some odd ones here and there. Hopefully it resolves it, whether that be switching from 4G to 5G or any modem issues you might be having. So hopefully we'll see some updates there. Now, as far as new features, I wanted to give a shout out or a thanks to Steve Mosier, Braden, and Matt for your help today. And the first new thing has to do with settings. So if we go under settings and we go to the main page, they've updated the notifications icon. So if we go to beta 3 or pretty much any other version, you can see that the notifications icon is slightly different. On the left is beta 3, on the right is beta 4. So it's now a little bell that they've updated to. Within the notifications menu, there's also an update as well. So it says scheduled summary, show previews, and screen sharing. So it's been updated just a little bit. Now, one thing to note that was a little bit odd is when I went into my settings, AirDrop was turned off. So it was turned to receiving off. If you're seeing that, make sure to change it to either contacts only or everyone. On every device I updated, it switched to off on its own. So that's something worth noting. Also, if we go to the lock screen, there's a small change as well. So on the lock screen, you'll see the little camera icon. This icon has been updated. And so if we take a look at beta 3, you'll see here on the right is beta 4, on the left is beta 3. It's very subtle, but it is a little bit different. And so as you can see there, it's slightly different. Now the next thing has to do with MagSafe. The MagSafe battery pack that they came out with recently now works natively with this device. So if we slide over, take a look at our widgets here, you'll see that, well, let me try it again. It will show up here in battery. Now it may take a moment, but you'll see it's already charging. There we go. It showed up in battery and now it's natively supported. Before it would just show that it was charging, like it was plugged in. Now it's showing the battery pack and the battery pack level. So that's something that's been updated in this update. Now the App Store has been updated slightly to match the design of iOS 15. So if you go into the App Store, tap on your account name in the upper right, you'll see that it looks a little bit different. Now all of the menus are in these little bubbles like they were before in all of the settings. So this wasn't updated prior to this update. Now it looks a little bit different and it just matches everything else in iOS 15. So that's been updated as well. Now something else they've updated is in widget stack. So if you press and hold on a widget stack, tap on edit stack, at the bottom you'll see smart rotate. We had this before, but it looked a little bit different. So they've since updated this, and you'll see on the left again is beta 3, on the right is beta 4, and it has a nice new animation. So you'll see they've added a nice little animation for this, and it's just a new icon overall. The same is true with widget suggestions. So again, it's a different icon there also. So that's something they've updated. Now they've updated focus modes as well. So if you go into one of your contacts under messages, you'll see there's a new option to share focus status. So that's something that's been updated and that's new. So that's been updated in iOS 15 beta 4. Now also within focus modes, if we go into a focus mode, you'll see we're on do not disturb. Maybe I switch to mindfulness. Then we go back home, turn it back off, you'll see it keeps the icon for the focus mode. Now, if I go out of control center, go back in, it will revert back to the normal focus icon. But this doesn't happen in the previous update. It's a small change, but it was just something worth noting. Now, also within the focus modes, if we tap on one, maybe we'll just add and we'll hit the X to go back to our settings. Under mindfulness, they've made a small change as well. So you'll see it says turn on automatically. And now under add schedule or automation, you now have a smart activation. This was on a different menu before or in a different location. So if we do the same thing here on beta 3 and we go back out and tap on mindfulness, we'll hit cancel here. You can see under mindfulness on beta 3, they have smart activation on its own. If you go under add schedule and automation, it looks a little bit different and it tells more about it. So it says automatically turn mindfulness on at relevant times throughout the day based on signals like your location, app usage, and more. So that's been updated in beta 4. It's just some slight changes here and there. Now, also, there was another new splash screen in Reminders the first time I opened it. Now, this had popped up by itself in previous versions as well, but it says organize with tags, optimize with smart lists, and lots more. So that's something new in beta 4 that's showing up for me. Now, also, they've made some nice changes in Safari. So if we go into Safari, you'll see that the refresh button is there all the time now. So no longer do I have to refresh by polling to get that to show up. Although I do like that feature where you can poll to refresh, it's there all the time. Also, the share icon is there all the time as well. So that part's new. And then if we go over to a web page that has maybe an article and we go into that article, let it load here, you'll see that it says reader available. And reader available allows you to use Apple's reading, and it's really nice to use, and it shows up and it's one touch now. So if you're in a different article, you can switch between that very quickly. So that's something that's been updated that's really nice. Also, when you long press on the address bar, you can now show your bookmarks. So it's a quicker way to get into your bookmarks overall, and it's really nice to see them add this. Now, another change in the control center is the notes icon. So you can see this is the notes icon. This is what it looks like now. And in the bottom right of beta 3, that's what it looks like before. So if we press and hold, you'll see the icons have changed a little bit. So there's a little bit of a change there. Now on the iPad, they've made some nice changes as well. The first thing that they've enabled is universal control. So under settings, if you go to your settings, go to general, and then go to AirPlay and handoff, if you turn off handoff and turn it back on, you'll see it says cursor and keyboard. Allow your cursor and keyboard to be used on any nearby Mac signed into your iCloud account. Now this will work universally with macOS Monterey, and I'll show that in a different video as macOS Monterey is taking a long time to update, but you can use your cursor across your iPad to your Mac and back and forth along with keyboard. So that should be really nice to use finally. Apple showed this off at their event and we haven't seen it enabled until now. Now in Safari, there's some nice changes as well on iPad. They've made it look much more similar to that of macOS Monterey. Now they've brought back the refresh button here at the top, which is really nice, and also share, and you can add a tab, and now you can switch between tabs and close them with this button again. So if you want to close a tab, just swipe it off the screen, and they've brought that back. This is something that I know a lot of people missed, including myself. I didn't like closing tabs by pressing the X. It's a minor change, but it's something that's welcomed and it seems much easier to use now. So that's something they've updated. But if you don't like this and you want the old style back, they've updated the settings there as well. And under Safari settings, you can now change this. So you can have the compact tab bar or separate tab bar. So that's something you can change between. So if you want to go back to the older style, you'll see it's back to what it was in beta 3. I prefer the regular traditional style. It's much easier to use on an iPad, and I think it looks great. So that's something that's been updated as well. Also, if we go over to the next page, you'll see there's a giant podcast widget. There's now an XL size podcast widget that's available with beta 4. So that's something that's been added. And then also Quick Notes, which is really nice. The first time I opened it, I got a splash screen. Unfortunately, I didn't save it, but you can see it's a little bit different here as well. So some of the icons have changed. You've got tabs here. So if you want to go into your Quick Note tabs, go home, switch between them. It's a really nice update and it shows your different links and things. It's a little easier to use. The interface has been refined even more. And I believe the radius on the corners is different as well. So overall, it looks really nice and I'm glad they've updated everything on the iPad finally and made it a little bit better in Safari. Now, as far as resolved issues, according to Apple's notes, they've resolved 24 issues, everything from maps to Safari, widgets, and more. But that doesn't mean they haven't resolved more than that. That's just the issues they've stated. There's also 31 known issues that still remain, from everything from files to SharePlay, focus, guided access, widgets, VPN, and more that still need to be resolved. So they're still working on issues. For example, I know a lot of people had issues with Spotlight search. It seems to be working right away this time, so Spotlight seems to be working fine. However, there are still issues such as green tint that I don't believe are resolved in this update. Nobody has told me either way specifically, as I can't duplicate it on my device, but a lot of people tell me usually right after, within an hour or so, they'll know whether or not there's green tint in this update. They haven't specifically said whether or not they've fixed it. So hopefully they'll fix it with this update. Like I've said before, Apple fixed it with iPhone 11 Pro and iPhone 11 Pro Max in late August. So maybe we'll see an additional small update to fix that. Now, as far as battery life overall, I've been using iOS 15 Beta 3 for the past couple of weeks, and battery life has been just okay. You'll see my maximum capacity is 97%, and the updates do not reduce this capacity, but rather recheck it. So if yours goes down, it's just rechecking the capacity. If it's an iPhone 11, it could recalibrate it even. So it's not necessarily making it go down, it's just rechecking it. As far as my overall usage, it hasn't been great. Yesterday, you'll see I used 2 hours and 13 minutes of screen on time, 3 hours and 20 minutes of screen off time, and used over 50% of my battery. And it varies greatly from day to day. So a couple days ago, 1 hour and 34 minutes of screen on time, 3 hours and 37 minutes of screen off time, usually playing music or something like that. You'll see music connected to a charger late at night sometimes. I'm getting about 6, maybe 8 hours of battery life on this update, so it's not particularly great as far as battery life goes, and usually it gets better as we get later on in the betas. So hopefully it improves over time. As far as the performance overall, performance on iPhone 6S Plus, which is the oldest phone that's supported, this and iPhone 6S, seems to be okay. It's not amazing. It's not a degradation from the previous version. It seems to be about the same. So you'll see a little bit of stuttering here and there as I scroll through lists, but it's about the exact same as before. But I did run a Geekbench test so that we can take a general look at what it was before. And let's take a look on the iPhone 12 Pro Max. So I ran this a little bit after installing it, and you'll see there's a small glitch there. Let's see if we can go to the history and take a look. And you'll see today it scored 1,597 for single core, 4,157 for multi-core. If we take a look at the history, you'll see here on July 14th, it was a little bit lower for single core and a little bit lower for multi-core. I'm actually seeing better scores this time around. So it just depends on what device you're using, but let's take a look at all of these so you can get a general idea of what to expect. Now from left to right, I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2021, followed by the iPhone 6S Plus, then the iPhone 11, and then the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And the scores seem to be better for me. I've seen some posts that they're a little bit worse, but as long as they're somewhere in the general range, it should be pretty good, unless you're seeing dramatic shifts back and forth. So it should be pretty good overall, but let me know what yours is in the comments below. And that leads me to, should you install iOS 15 Beta 4? And if you're already on Beta 3, then absolutely. You'll benefit from bug fixes, additional updates, and the changes I've already mentioned. However, if you're on iOS 14.7.1 that released the other day, and you want to see if this will fix an issue you're having with that update, I would not recommend installing the beta. I would wait a little bit and see how it goes, as betas are typically buggy and will have issues. Like I said before, there are known issues in this update. And if you're having issues, make sure you report them in the feedback app, then Apple can work on them and resolve them. Sometimes they'll even contact you back and then work on resolving those. Now, as far as when to expect iOS 15 Beta 5, right now we're on a bi-weekly basis, so we've seen an update every 2 weeks or so, or minus a day at this point. So we had Beta 3 on the 14th, we had Beta 4 today, and so we may be on a weekly schedule, as Apple tends to switch to that, usually around Beta 5, so we could see one as soon as early next week, or they could still be on a bi-weekly basis. But either way, we need to have enough betas to make it stable enough so that it can release sometime in mid to late September like they normally do. So that's usually what they do. They'll release it right around the time they announce the iPhone 13, and we'll see the final version. So we're just a few weeks out, or a month and a half out from a final release. Time's going by very quickly, so we could see one next week and then see another few betas at that time. So I'm looking forward to see what they do with this update and making it more and more stable. Now, if you found anything else new, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And if I find anything else significant, of course, I'll do a follow-up video with additional features and more. And if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.